بسم اللہ الرحمن الرحیم، قل هو الله احد، اللہ الصمد، لم یلد ولم یولد ولم یکن له کفوا احد. آئی ویلکم یو ایٹ دا ڈیفینس ویوسے آف پی ایچ ڈی کمپیوٹر سائنس اسکالر مسٹر محمد عتیق. دا ٹائٹل آف ہز تھیسس از ملٹی پیرامیٹرک انالیسز آف کیو او ایس ان وائرلیس سینسر نیٹ ورک اے ڈیٹا ڈریون اپروچ. This is supervised by Dr. Muhammad Khalil Afzal. اس وقت موجود ہیں، ان سے گزارش ہے کہ وہ بھی وہاں پہ جو بھی کانفرنس روم ہے کیمرہ ہوگا وہ سوئچ آن کر لیں اپنی ویڈیو. مجھے سپروائزر نظر نہیں آ رہے ابھی.
خلیل افضل کے نام سے سر آ رہے ہیں نظر،
ان کا کیمرہ آن کروا رہے ہیں
سر، ہمیں تو نظر آ رہے ہیں.
اچھا ٹھیک ہے، ناؤ آئی کین سی، تھینک یو. ان کے کو سپروائزر ہیں ڈاکٹر محمد نعیم. ڈاکٹر محمد نعیم بھی موجود ہیں؟
نہیں سر، ڈاکٹر نعیم صاحب.
ٹھیک ہے. آئی ایم ویری تھینک فل ٹو آور ایکسٹرنل ایگزامینرز پروفیسر ڈاکٹر یونس جاوید، وائس چانسلر ہائی ٹیک یونیورسٹی ٹیکسلا، اینڈ پروفیسر ڈاکٹر الماس، ڈین یونیورسٹی اوا، فار ٹیکنگ دیر ویلیویبل ٹائم آؤٹ آف دیر بزی اسکیجول فار کنڈکٹنگ دس وائی واسے اینڈ فائنل ڈیفینس. دا فائنل ڈیفینس اینڈ وائی واسے ول بی ان تھری پارٹس. دا فسٹ از پریزنٹیشن بائی دا اسکالر وچ از آف 40 منٹس. Once again, I am repeating, it is 40 minutes. So please be the time. It will be followed up with questions and answers session from the panel of examiners and general audience. As per our previous practice, we will conduct it at the end of presentation. Finally, there will be closed panel discussion and finalization of the result by the examination panel and its announcement. So as per program, I would like to invite Mr. Atif to start the presentation.
Thank you very much, sir. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I'm Muhammad Atif, and the topic of my thesis is Multiparametric Analysis of Quality of Service in Wireless Sensor Networks, a Data-Driven Approach. So I begin with the introduction. wireless sensor networks are ubiquitous. They are found everywhere. When wireless sensor networks were originally designed and thought of, the primary consideration was energy, that these will be deployed in remote areas and accessing and recharging them will not be easy repeatedly. So if they can optimize energy consumption, they are very good choice for deployment in remote areas. However, with the passage of time, the application areas have grown, and particularly since wireless sensor networks serve as the basis of the realization of the modern day technology, Internet of Things. So the application areas have grown and have become diverse, and the quality of service has become a very important consideration in facilitating the applications which are demanding in the IoT domain. If we talk about quality of service context, quality of service can be seen at different levels. Particularly when we talk about Internet of Things, it can be seen at service level as well as at the network level. When we talk about quality of service at the service level, that means we are talking about different metrics like response time and throughput without giving any consideration to the internals of the Internet of Things. So the quality of service predicted at service level is abstract. It is obviously less complex, but it is coarse-grained. On the other end, we can see quality of service at the network level. At the network level, we will be talking about the internals of any network, because Internet of Things is composed of many different things, and communication network is one of them, and wireless sensor network is one popular technology which is enabling the realization of Internet of Things. So if we see quality of service at the network level, for example, at the wireless sensor network level, we will be talking about the internals of the wireless sensor networks, and we will be thinking about the information contained within wireless sensor network at a fine-grained interval. So it will be more complex, but it will be more informed. The third aspect that I want to talk about is adaptivity. The quality of service in modern communication systems is assumed to be adaptive. It is hoped to be adaptive. So in an adaptive system, it should be closed in a self-learning loop where it can observe the phenomena occurring around and it can fine-tune its characteristics and parameters to adjust accordingly. Now, when we talk about research conventions to facilitate different aspects of communication systems, including quality of service, the research begins at device level. A device has a local view and local control. A sensor can play with its own parameters only. It obviously does not control any of the other components involved in the network. So improving network-wide quality of service, considering a single device, is obviously a very difficult task. And if we talk about conventional solutions, usually we tend to propose new protocols or modify existing protocols. We propose some cross-layer approaches. We tend to fine-tune some parameters if possible. But anything which is proposed in communication systems generally has to go through a very, very tedious, strenuous, time-consuming, and resource-hungry practice of standardization and then implementation, which takes years, and many of the potential ideas which may have good potential cannot be realized because of the time-consuming and resource-hungry practices. Then if we talk about centrality, the centrality can be provided through a sink. So in a wireless sensor network, we can think of a sink which is basically collecting all sorts of data from different sources. But if we talk about quality of service optimization, the optimization problems in nature are NP-hard, so we can't really deal with those interactable problems considering the optimization of multiple metrics. And also, they lack in adaptivity. The solutions proposed in a conventional styles are not adaptive. So there have been efforts, growing efforts, to facilitate adaptivity in such design, which involves predictive modeling of quality of service metrics. And to complement the available deployment by facilitating this adaptive loop. And multiple metrics can be simultaneously considered when we talk about adaptive systems, which are basically assumed to be running using machine learning. And in any such data-driven system, data is of extreme importance. So what we have done in this thesis at a bare level is that we have used communication parameters from wireless sensor networks. And we have understood the relationships with the quality of service metrics. Then the next task is to identify suitable features for predictions, then predict quality of service metrics based on variations in values of communication parameters. And this is proposed as a complement to existing systems deployment. So we are not claiming that this is a replacement design. Any deployed system can benefit from such a design because it is basically there to take advantage of whatever fine-tuning is available in the system. And this is proposed as a first step in designing a cognitive quality of service framework for wireless sensor networks-driven Internet of Things. Next, we look at the problem. The problem that we try to address in this thesis is that how to complement adaptive quality of service in evolving wireless sensor networks without having to devise new protocols, or to face the huge challenges of standardization and incorporating them in hardware, and then without having to keep reinventing the wheel as the network evolves, requirements change. That means it should be self-learning and adaptive, and also without having to solve interactable optimization problems. The solution that we have adopted for this purpose is that we can play with a number of network parameters. For example, in our case, we have the list of parameters, including inter-arrival time, packet size, maximum transmissions, transmission power, max queue size, distance, retry delay, overflow, and average actual queue size. And based on these parameters, we can adopt some intelligent learning technology, some kind of machine learning, to learn their relationship with the metrics like packet delivery ratio, delay, signal to noise ratio, and energy consumption. So if we can understand the relationship of these communication parameters and the variations in their values with these quality of service metrics, it is possible to predict them. And if we can predict them, we can facilitate adaptivity in any existing system.
Right,
The motivation behind this research is that future communication systems are obviously thought and expected to be adaptive and self-learning. Exhaustive solutions are no more possible because it is a well-established fact that any optimization problem is interactable. So they are too complex and they do not scale. And obviously they lack in intelligence and adaptivity as well. So data-driven techniques have grown in popularity of late and have been adopted in a number of application areas. So they are a major enabler for intelligent and adaptive designs, and systems learn and adapt as network design, scale, and application requirements evolve. The contributions that we have made in order to achieve our goals is that we aim to complement quality of service in terms of reliability, latency, signal-to-noise ratio, and energy in wireless sensor networks using machine learning. The feature space in this case include a number of configurable parameters, which have been described on a previous slide already, and we will discuss them in detail later as well. And the outcome is obviously the prediction of quality of service metrics based on these parameters. We have been able to publish 3 journal articles. One was focusing on delay prediction. The other was focusing reliability, and the third one was considering signal to noise ratio and packet delivery ratio together. And we have also worked on an NRPU based project, which was closely associated with this thesis, and a submission has been made against that as well. Next, we discuss related work. When we talk about the related work, we have divided the related work in 2 categories. One, the legacy solutions to facilitate quality of service, and the others are the data-driven solutions to facilitate quality of service solutions. So we first discuss the legacy solutions. In any legacy solution, we have some kind of optimization objective associated with it. For example, we want to optimize one or multiple metrics. So that requires solving interactable problems, as we have discussed earlier. And obviously the scheme that we will be following to achieve that goal is that this is usually proposed as a new protocol, and realization of any new protocol is extremely hard. We understand that the standardization process is long and hefty, and also the implementation requires a lot of monetary, a lot of time, and a lot of commercial interest. And when we talk about multiple metrics being considered together, it becomes even harder. So joint considerations of metrics becomes even harder, and it have to afford a lot of trade-offs. So what we have done in this thesis is that we have considered a number of metrics together. It was possible to consider these many metrics together because we are not solving any intractable optimization problem. We are basically trying to facilitate the prediction of these metrics using an intelligent design based on machine learning. So the other category is the data-driven solutions. Like the solution that we have proposed, we discussed the relevance and the significance of our contribution in comparison to the data-driven solutions, which are pervasive now. The data-driven solutions, as I discussed earlier, that the quality of service is predicted at 2 levels. One is at the service level and the other is at the network level. The service level prediction does not pay any regard to the internal architecture or internal details of anything. It just takes the quality of service value at abstract level. And for example, the most popular metrics that have been predicted based on data-driven techniques are response time and throughput, which are listed here. And usually the task is to predict the missing values. So we have a metrics of values, and what we do is we use techniques like metrics factorization, which is the most popular technique in this case, and neural networks as well, to predict those missing values. And this is done at the service level. And primarily the research that we find in literature is based on one very popular public data set available from Zhang. One major limitation that we'll see here is that if we predict the quality of service at service level, there is no input involved in it because the input is directly something that will be missing from the matrix. So we will be predicting the values from the matrix itself. So there will be no internal characteristics of the network or any other component of Internet of Things involved in this. The other level at which the quality of service can be predicted is the network level. When we talk about network level, we have obviously a possibility of considering a number of metrics that can be taken as input to train the machine learning models. For example, here we can see a list of metrics listed here, which are considered by different proposed studies. So one major limitation that we find in these studies is that very few parameters are considered. For example, if we look at the first one, we see that it is using signal to noise ratio and packet reception rate as input. The next one is considering distance, traffic rate, and received packet and erroneous packets as input. And the third one is considering grid size, transmission power, distance, and lifetime as input. In addition to that, even more important thing is that these studies have frequently used receiver side parameters to train the machine learning models at sender side. Now it becomes quite ironic that we use receiver side quantities to predict the quantities on a sender side. So that is, I would say, I personally feel that is quite an impractical consideration if we take receiver side quantities and predict the values on the sender side, because we want to make the predictions for the receiver side. So the data set that we have used is basically publicly available, and it is arguably the richest data set in terms of the number of parameters that it uses and the variations of those parameters. And it uses inter-arrival time or traffic rate, packet size.
ये भी आपकी आवाज नहीं आ रही
आवाज आवाज को देखिएगा गाने
कैन यू हियर मी नाउ सर
यस
Okay, so one major limitation that I've mentioned is that the studies proposed that use data-driven techniques to predict quality of service metrics at the network level lack in number of parameters that they use. And also many of these studies use receiver side quantities to predict, to make predictions at the sender level, which is ironic in its very own right. So for example, if we see at this study, they use packet reception rate and SNR as input. Now packet reception rate and SNR both are receiver side quantities. Similarly, if we look at this study, they use distance, traffic rate, received packet and erroneous packets as input. So in this case, only distance and traffic rate can be configured on the sender side, and both received packet and erroneous packets are receiver side quantities. So if we use received packet or erroneous packet to predict a metric like packet loss ratio, that is pretty much doing the same thing in another form, just transforming the things. The third study basically uses grid size, transmission power, distance, and lifetime. Now, one major problem with this is that they are predicting these three metrics, lifetime, transmission power, and distance, considering these three metrics in addition to the grid size. So what we have done is that the data set that we have used is quite comprehensive. It uses a number of metrics, inter-arrival time or the traffic rate, packet size, queue size, max transmissions, retry delay, transmission power, distance, number of overflows, actual queue size, and actual transmissions. And the metrics that we have considered are pure quality of service metrics in that sense, packet delivery ratio, signal to noise ratio, energy consumption, and delay. So we briefly look at how the data looks like. The data that we have used is basically collected from parameters at three different layers, application, MAC or the medium access control layer, and the physical layer. So at application layer, the parameters that are available are inter-arrival time and packet size. At medium access control layer, we have maximum queue size and maximum transmissions and retry delay. And on physical layer, we have transmission power and distance. In addition to these seven pre-configured parameters, the values of which are listed here, for example, for traffic rate, the interval used are 10, 15, 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, and 50 milliseconds, and so on. The values are mentioned for all these parameters. So in addition to these seven pre-configured parameters, we have information available about three per packet parameters as well. So we have the recording of actual queue size, the overflow, which is obviously a real value, because when we try to transmit a packet, it can only be determined then whether the overflow is occurring due to the queue being full or not. And similarly, average transmission, actual transmission attempts. So based on these values, which are listed here for all these parameters, we have 48,384 configurations of these parameters. Against each of these configurations, we have information about 300 packet transmissions. So for all those 300 packet transmissions, the per packet data is recorded, the average actual, the actual queue size, buffer overflow, and transmission attempts. Next, we present a static, statistical and visual analysis of the data set that we have used. So first, we have shown the relevance of these parameters with delay. The impact of, for example, packet size and actual average actual queue size on the delay. So we clearly see that the delay values increase as the packet size increases. Now, this is quite intuitive and understandable, because if we transmit bigger packets, the queues will be bigger and the queuing delay will dominate as well. And one of the biggest source of delay in the system is obviously queuing delay, because it causes the major jitter in any communication system, including wireless systems. The next thing is the effect of actual queue size on the delay. So that is also quite intuitive, that if the queues are bigger, the delay is also going to be bigger. Okay. Next, we see the effect of multiple of parameters on delay. For example, in figure 8A, we can see the effect of transmission power and actual average actual queue size. So the tendency with transmission power is that as transmission power grows, the chances of success of transmission also grow. And similarly, when the average actual queue size is small, the queuing delay is obviously going to be small. So we can see that the delay decreases as the average actual queue size decreases and the transmission power increases. And we see the effect when the values go in the other direction. Similarly, the effect of average actual transmissions and average actual queue size is shown in figure 8B. Now, in this case, the effect of average actual queue size is relatively deterministic. However, the impact of average actual transmissions is not very deterministic. That is because it is not recorded at that fine grade intervals. It is recorded at coarse grade intervals, and we see a varying behavior. It can go both ways. The delay can move both ways as the value of average actual transmission changes. So it turns out that average actual queue size, average actual transmissions, and packet size are among the most dominant factors to determine the delay. Next, we see the impact of these parameters on signal-to-noise ratio. So we see as the transmission power increases, the signal-to-noise ratio also increases, because the signal strength is expected to improve in that case. And we see a bit of deterioration when the transmission power level reaches 27 and 31, because at 27 and 31, it is quite a lot of transmission power, more than necessary. So when the transmission power is too high, it causes some deterioration and interference as well. So we see as the transmission power generally improves, the signal to noise ratio improves. On the other hand, we see the impact of distance. So as the distance, we know that the signals basically fade in a square proportion to the distance. So as the distance keeps increasing, the signal to noise ratio keeps decreasing. And then we see the impact of multiple of these parameters. For example, in figure 10A, we see the impact of distance and transmission power combined on signal to noise ratio. So in this case, we see that as the distance increases and transmission power decreases, the signal to noise ratio decreases. Similarly, in figure 10B, we see the impact of transmission power and packet size. Again, the trend is same, that as packet size decreases, the signal to noise ratio increases. So we can conclude that parameters like transmission power, distance, and packet size dominate in determining the outcome of signal-to-noise ratio. Next, we see the impact of these parameters on packet delivery ratio. So for example, again, we can see the effect of transmission power. When transmission power is increasing, the packet delivery ratio is also increasing. Other than the fact that when it is too high, it causes some kind of interference and overhearing, and these kind of effects does hamper the packet delivery ratio a bit. But in general, there is a level until which we increase the transmission power level, and it keeps improving the packet delivery ratio. The second is the effect of inter-arrival time. Inter-arrival time basically is the pause time between transmission of two successive packets. So as the inter-arrival time increases, the packet delivery ratio increases, because if we transmit less, obviously there is less competition on the medium, so the chances of success of delivery is obviously more. However, obviously the effect of on the throughput will be negative in this case. And then we also see the impact of packet size on packet delivery ratio. So again, we see it is also quite intuitive to understand that as packet size increases, the packet delivery ratio decreases. And here we see the effect of multiple of these parameters on packet size. So in figure 12A, we can see the effect of average overflows. Now, average overflow is obviously expected to determine packet delivery ratio in a very positive way, because the number of overflows directly determine the packet of packets lost due to overflows. And there is another thing in that when queuing is more, the chances of losses are more. So we can see the effect of both overflows and actual queue size on packet delivery ratio. So if the overflows are less, packet delivery ratio is expected to be more. And similarly, in figure 12B, you can see the impact size and distance on packet delivery ratio. So packet delivery ratio decreases as distance increases and packet size increases. So we can say that the parameters like transmission power, inter-arrival time, overflows, average, actual queue size, and packet size are dominant in determining the fate of packet delivery ratio. Next is energy consumption. So again, we can see the effect of packet size on energy consumption. So energy consumption decreases as packet size increases. Now, this is primarily because when we talk about the energy consumption is recorded in microjoules per bit. This effect is primarily because of the fact that as the size of packet is increased, the fraction of control data decreases in that. So we have to consume less energy per data bit. So if packet size is small, obviously the header size usually remains the constant. In this case, it is 27 bytes, for example. So if the fraction of control data is more, the energy consumption for positive data bit will be more. Similarly, for transmission power, we see that the energy consumption increases slowly as the transmission power is increased, other than the fact when the transmission power is too low, because when transmission power is minimum, for example, 3 on the first case, we see that there are lots of losses, so there is less successful delivery, so the energy consumption is really at peak. Otherwise, it usually increases as the transmission power is increased. And same is the effect with distance. As the distance increases, energy consumption is expected to increase, because in combination with transmission power, we can determine that increasing distance does decrease the chances of success of communication. The effect of multiple of these parameters is revealed here in figure 14A. We can see the impact of packet size and max transmissions, which is again intuitive to understand, and the effect of transmission power and inter-arrival time. The more noticeable thing, for example, in figure 14B is that when transmission power is 3, the energy consumption is pretty much in the outlier area. So generally, the energy consumption remains within 0.3 or so. But in this case, you can see that it is going even up to 159, 160 or so. So this is the outlier area, and we will determine the fate of this outlier area on the next slide. So we can see that the parameters like transmission power, inter-arrival time, max transmission, and packet size are dominant in determining the fate of energy consumption. So different quality of service metrics are affected by different parameters differently. Now, here we see the relationship between packet delivery ratio and energy consumption in figure 15. We see that when packet delivery ratio falls below 0.5, or particularly I would say 0.25, the energy consumption starts rising enormously. So we say that the 99th, the observation from data tells us that the 99th percentile of energy consumption remains under 0.3 microjoules per bit when packet delivery ratio is more than 0.25. So if we keep this data combined, it is extremely difficult to perform any good learning on this. So what we have done is we have resorted to the Z-score, and we have split the energy consumption data in two parts. So we have used the PDR median and 3 into standard deviation of packet DR to make two slices. So these two slices give us two different proportions for energy consumption data. And what we see is that the left proportion where packet delivery ratio is less than 0.25, only 4.9% of the data lies. We call it energy consumption sparse. And the other fraction where packet delivery ratio is more than or equal to 0.25, that contains 95.1% data. We regard it as EC dense. Although we can regard the EC sparse as the outlier, but we have considered it for prediction. And this fact can also be witnessed here in by another angle. In figure 16b, we can see when transmission power is 3, the packet delivery ratio is losing its ground here, and the energy consumption is taking a hike. So this is that particular area when energy, when transmission power is too low, and a bit of hike is here as well, and energy consumption is 7. When transmission power is 7. Next, we present the system model. The system model can be thought of any deployment that uses wireless sensor networks-based IoT deployment. It could be a healthcare facility, it could be agricultural areas, it could be small to medium scale buildings, hotels, residences, and all also. So what happens basically is that the data is communicated from different localities to any service providing facility. So in addition to communicating the sensors data or the wireless sensor network or IoT specific data, what we propose is that the performance data can also be relayed with that. And when that performance data is communicated to that central location, there can be an intelligent server which will be hosting, which will be collecting this information in addition to the sensor data. And it will be doing some pre-processing over that. It will be identifying the set of features and the set of metrics in that. So after that statistical analysis, it can perform some machine learning. And based on that machine learning, it can prepare a set of vectors of recommendations where it can suggest that if you want to achieve this particular quality of service goal, for example, if you want to have a packet delivery ratio minimum at 0.8, you need to set your these parameters within these ranges. So we have used deep learning, deep neural networks, to train our machine learning models. The input for the deep neural networks basically is composed of 10 parameters that I've already discussed and are listed here, inter-arrival time, packet size, and so on and so forth, and obviously the quality of service metrics. So based on these 48,384 observations, we train our machine learning model. The term parameter and features will both be used interchangeably from now on, because what we regard as parameters in sense of wireless networks will be regarded as features in terms of machine learning. The hyperparameters are basically empirically chosen. The number of hidden layers are 10. The number of neurons per layer are 64. The learning rate is set to 0.001. The epochs used for trainings are 500. For EC sparse, we had to use 1500 or so, because it keeps learning if we increase the number of epochs. And the activation function used for the purpose of neural networks is rectified linear unit or relay. The conventional cycle of forward pass, backward pass, and gradient descent is performed on the data while we are learning. So the forward pass basically applies the weight and computes the input for the next layers. The backward pass basically moves backward in the network and calculates the gradients or the rate of change. And then based on those rates of changes, the new weights are calculated using the gradient descent. The metrics that we have used are bare error and the mean absolute error. The mean absolute error obviously takes the absolute value of the difference between the actual value and predicted value and averages it over a number of values that we have trained ultimately. Sorry, this is algorithm. Where is algorithm one? So this is our basic algorithm for learning. So what it does is that it takes a set of features and a set of targets, and it does some cross-validation slicing as well. And what it does is it trains the data according to the equations that we have already mentioned, the forward pass, the backward pass, and the gradient descent until it converges. This is our basic second algorithm, which basically uses that quality of service predict function, which is mentioned here. So we give it these features, and its output is the recommendations that it will prepare, and it will simply call this quality of service predict function, supply it the data, features, and target, and will receive recommendations as output. Then we have fine-tuned a bit of feature selection here as well. Although the primary purpose of this thesis is not doing feature selection, but we have simply applied some basic Pearson correlation-based feature selection and seen the results of that. So what we do here is that for each target and the target, we first find the correlation scores. So for each target or the metric, we find the correlation score, the Pearson correlation score there. And then in the first pass of the feature selection, what we do is the feature is critical. We need to identify the critical features. So we say that feature is critical for a metric if it is not already in critical features list, and its correlation score with any of the critical features is less than the correlation score with the metric under consideration. So in the beginning, for any target, there will be no critical feature. So when we add the first feature as critical feature, while adding the second feature, we will see, does this second feature has a correlation score with the metric higher than any other metric which has already been included in the critical feature set. So what why we have done this is to avoid adding redundant features. For example, we have two, as an example, I can say we have two features, for example, actual cube size and maximum cube size. Now, both basically do the same thing, but actual cue size does the same thing at much fine grained interval. So generally, the outcome or the prediction error in terms in case of actual cue size is much lesser compared to maximum cue size. So if we use both maximum cue size and actual cue size, generally it does not help in learning anymore. So the feature selection or the critical feature identification that we have applied is basically based on this analogy. So we filter out those features which are either having very low correlation score or are redundant due to any other features. In the second pass, we relax this by 115%. And actually, we can use four passes. We can, in the third phase, we relax it by 130% and so on. And finally, what we can do is we can select a cutoff or a threshold where we can decide that, okay, if the learning reaches this much, then we don't need to do any further. It is going to be insignificant, or it is something which is not desired or required. Next, we demonstrate the results that we have prepared based on the procedure applied. So the results will be presented in the form of prediction. Results will be separately presented for each of the metrics. And this, we have presented results for packet delivery ratio, EC only for the dense pass, energy consumption, signal to noise ratio, and delay. And the presentation has been made in the following styles. One is that we have plotted actual values against the predicted values. The second is that we have listed the mean absolute error for each individual feature. The next is that we list the mean absolute error for different combinations of the features, just to know where we reach the minimum. And then we have also demonstrated the histogram and cumulative distribution function of the absolute percentage error. And finally, we also present a bit of comparison of the best baseline and CFI, or the critical feature identification algorithm that I've just mentioned previously. So in the prediction results, we can see this is the prediction result for packet delivery ratio. We can see in figure 18A, the x-axis tell us the true values, and the y-axis tell us the predicted values. And we see that the values are primarily pretty much well aligned with the diagonal, and the larger density of these values exist in the upper interval, because there are more values which are closer to the max of the packet delivery ratio. And similarly, the same is demonstrated here in three fine-grained intervals. So these are some 600 values in a lower interval, in a higher interval, and in yet and yet very higher interval. So the density becomes much more here. So we can see that the actual values and predicted values are very well aligned in this case. The next is we show the effect of each feature on learning. So we see that overflow, actual transmissions, and actual queue size are very dominant in determining packet delivery ratio. We have already seen it statistically, and we can see it as prediction outcome as well, that the prediction error or the mean absolute error for these three metrics is quite low. Overflows is particularly low because overflows directly determine, but obviously the next, the other factor that determine packet loss ratio here is the transmission attempts made and the queue. Queue size, more queue size also determines it very well. And beyond that, the features that determine packet delivery ratio are also intuitive. The traffic rate, transmission power, and distance. In any communication system, these parameters are vital parameters. But we see that the per packet information is more important in determining the outcome of packet delivery ratio compared to the features. Here we can see the combination of these features, the different combinations of these features. So the results that we have revealed here are based on the CFI, the critical features identified. So we see that in this case, the best feature individual feature was overflows, which had the prediction error of 0.058. When we combine two features, for example, overflows and transmission powers, the error starts reducing. So we get 0.046 in this case, and it keeps decreasing until we reach C4. We have five features like overflows, transmission power, distance, actual queue size, and actual transmissions. And we reach this minimum threshold, which is 0.012. And the range of packet delivery ratio is obviously from 0 to 1. So this is quite acceptable figure for error in this case. And we can see that the addition of any other features does not help learning as much. In fact, we see a bit of deterioration in the learning. Here we have shown the histogram and CDF of the error, and we can see that a very large proportion of the packets are, a very large proportion of the values is actually very accurately predicted. The 90th percentile is 4.2% in this case, which simply means that the 90% of the cases, the error remained within, for 90% of the cases, the error remained around 4%, or the prediction accuracy remained around 96%. Next is we show the results for energy consumption. And as I said earlier, that in thesis, I've mentioned both dense and sparse parts. But here we will be covering only dense part because it contains the bulk of the data for energy consumption. And we again see that data, the predicted values and the true values are very well aligned along diagonal. The range is also quite limited. In this case, pretty much all the data is lying within the interval of 0.1 to 0.5. And the fine-grained intervals are also shown here. This is almost 13,000 data points here. So we have shown these around 600-650 data points here from different ranges, from the low range, from the middle range, and from the higher range. And as regard individual features, so we see that mean absolute error for predicting energy consumption is minimum against packet size and transmission power. So packet size and transmission power both yield very good, but other features, although they do not differ from each in terms of contribution, but still they have some contribution, as we will see in the combination. So packet size and transmission power are the most dominant features in resulting in a good prediction error in case of energy consumption, the dense part. So when we talk about combinations, we see that from the minimum of 0.052, adding one feature, we reach 0.02. So packet size and transmission power considered together result in very low value for a prediction error for energy consumption. As we keep on adding feature, we reach this minimum figure of 0.006. 0.006. And okay, so this is for EC dense, the histogram, the 90th percentile is 5.4% in this case. The next are the prediction results for SNR. We can see pretty much the same result for that. And the error histogram again reveals that the 90th percentile is 3.6%. And for delay, because the data, the range of delay was quite high. It was from it reached almost up to 3000 milliseconds. So we see that the variation is a little bit more in this case. And the 90th percentile is almost 70% in this case. this is a brief comparison of BEST, CFI, and all features. All is when we use, that is the exhaustive baseline method. BEST is the handpicked features, right, by drawing all possible combination, and CFI is if he applies a CFI. So we can see that even a simple correlation, Pearson correlation based algorithm does well in picking the correct features. However, feature selection can be done at a much finer scale and using better methods. And finally, we also reveal a bit of analysis of the hyperparameters. We have shown the effect of different fractions of training data. For example, in case of packet delivery ratio, 10% training data does well. And if we apply, if we then analyze the number of hidden units, number of hidden layers, for 10% of the training data, we see that 2 layers do well and 40 neurons per layer do well in case of packet delivery ratio. In case of SNR, 10% training data, 4 hidden layers and 40 neurons per layer do well. And in case of energy consumption, we see 20% of the training data, 2 layers and 20 neurons per layer give us good result. And in case of delay, we use 10%. If we use 10% training data like here and 6 layers like here, we get a minimum of error and 20 neurons per layer it does well. So we have just analyzed, make a bit of brief analysis of hyperparameters as well. The limitations associated with this work are that the data we have used obviously is from particular domain, so there's a domain bias. There is a major limitation of parameters as well, although this data set is quite comprehensive, but still there are a number of other features to be considered. And then analysis in a real deploy, although this data set is collected from a real environment, but still in a real working prototype of the system is something which needs to be realized in order to see the real effectivity of this proposed solution. And advanced feature selection techniques is obviously something that can be considered as well. Currently, we have extended our study to include more and diverse parameters, including different, we have considered different protocol layers, different protocols from different layers, even MAC layer protocols and routing matrix. And we are running our experiments in the VILAB, which is basically a FAT4FI plus hosted test bed at University of Ghent, Belgium. And in future, we aim to develop a working prototype of such a predictive framework so that we can identify the issues in the real deployments as well. So that's it for my presentation. Thank you very much for your time and listening.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Teek, especially for completion within the time. Good. Now, seminars are requested to please proceed for Viva.